Your Excellencies, Minister for Foreign Affairs, Commissioner for Social Affairs of the African Union, Deputy Minister for Culture, Ambassadors of African countries in Athens, distinguished speakers, dear colleagues, dear guests. I would like to extend a warm welcome at this 2021 Africa Day, organized by the Group of African Ambassadors in Athens in collaboration with the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. For those who don't know me, I'm Vasiliki Gounari, Director for Sub-Saharan Africa at the Greek Ministry of Foreign Affairs. The celebration of Africa Day is very particular this year due to the pandemic. Technology, on the other hand, offers also great potential. It is bridging distances that can make remote participation possible. We are grateful to all those participating in this third Africa Day from here in Athens and from overseas. May 25th marks the commemoration of the foundation of African Union around the world. We are celebrating its achievements and its important contribution in regional security, prosperity, and stability. When we were designing with my colleague, distinguished ambassador of South Africa, Ms. Beryl, Sisulu, the content of the event, our ambition was to send a strong signal commitment and to highlight the opportunities and prospects of cooperation between Greece and our African partners. We are honored that the Greek Minister for Foreign Affairs, Mr. Dendias, will open our event. We are also honored by the participation of Her Excellency Amira Elfadil, Commissioner for Social Affairs of the African Union. Equally, as this year we celebrate African culture, heritage, and creativity, the participation of Deputy Minister for Culture and Sport, Mr. Yatromanolakis, will provide us with an important additional perspective. A panel of distinguished speakers will shed light on most pertinent for the African continent issues. Our distinguished colleague, Ambassador Ismail Ahmed Kairat of Egypt, will be the last speaker before closing the event. Let me now turn to the distinguished ambassador of South Africa to Greece, Mrs. Beryl Sisulu, Dean of the Group of African Ambassadors in Athens, whom I would like to thank wholeheartedly for taking the initiative for the organization of the online Africa Day this year, for her ideas and the great cooperation we had in the organization of our event. Ambassador Sisulu enjoys a long and successful career. Her many other positions before being appointed as Ambassador of South Africa to Greece include ambassadorial postings to Japan, Australia, and Norway, amongst others. Without further ado, dear Beryl, I hand over the floor to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Program Director. Good afternoon. In the year of arts, culture, and heritage, leave us for building the Africa we want. The moderator, Ms. Vasiliki Gounari, Ambassador, Director for Sub-Saharan Africa, Ministry of Foreign Affairs. His Excellency, Mr. Nikos Dendias, Minister of Foreign Affairs of the Hellenic Republic, Her Excellency Ms. Amira Elfadil, Mohammed Elfadil, Commissioner for Social Affairs of the African Union, His Excellency Mr. Nicholas Yatromanolikas, Deputy Minister of Culture and Sports of the Hellenic Republic, Mr. Spyrios Kouvelis, former Minister of State for Foreign Economic, Cultural and Environmental Affairs of the Hellenic Republic, Mr. Michalis Saris, former Minister of Economic Affairs of Cyprus, Dr. Sotiris Mouzouris, President and Founder of the Hellenic African Chamber of Commerce, Your Excellencies, fellow African ambassadors, distinguished panelists and guests, ladies and gentlemen, today marks the third time that some of the ambassadors here present meet in this manner to give credence to our confidence in our relationship with the Hellenic Republic. We are once again honored to celebrate Africa Day with the wonderful support in the presence of His Excellency, Mr. Dendias, the Honorable Minister of Foreign Affairs of the Hellenic Republic. I am tempted to note at the very beginning, Mr. Minister, your very kind gesture in the demonstration of goodwill in placing at your disposal your dedicated and professional staff from the ministry. We sincerely appreciate the time you have set aside from your busy schedule to grace us with your presence as we celebrate this day. You have demonstrated to us a true friendship as a co-host of this event. And I should believe that I echo the sentiments of my colleagues in expressing our utmost gratitude. The celebration of Africa Day is a rededication by the sons and daughters of Africa to the noble ideals of continental unity and renaissance. It is a recommitment to the enduring pan-African vision of an integrated, prosperous, and peaceful Africa. As we meet here today, we are proud as Africans to declare openly the right moment has come for our nations to bring to bear their collective strength in order to enhance the competitiveness of the continent in the global economy. Africa recently recorded history when 4 months ago, the world witnessed the launch of the African Continental Free Trade Area, AFTA, the world's largest common trading area since the establishment of the WTO. The free trade area is encompassing all 55 states of Africa. This landmark agreement by African leaders creates a continental free trade zone with a combined gross domestic product of $3.4 trillion. This is one of the flagship projects under the African Union's Agenda 2063, the Africa that we want. It is our vision that soon each of our respective countries represented here will serve in its own right as a gateway into the continental free trade of over 1.2 billion people across Africa. We meet today at a time when Africa is serious about turning the tide against exploitation and economic dependency. Africa is on an upward trend and seeks mutually beneficial relations based on a genuine partnership with the rest of the world. We take seriously our relationship with the Hellenic government and the people of this wonderful country. This forum represents a united voice and amplifies our commitment as the people of Africa to maintain and consolidate our historic relations with the government and the people of the Hellenic Republic. It is our fervent desire to maintain this important collaboration with the ministry. We should perhaps in future aim to direct our engagements towards achieving defined outcomes that are beneficial for our relationship in order to enhance the meaning and purpose of our interactions. Program Director, Excellencies, The 34th ordinary session of the African Union Summit adopted the theme Arts, Culture, Heritage, Levers for Building the Africa We Want for celebrating of this year's Africa Day. We are honored to have a rich program with a lineup of eminent speakers from diverse disciplines and professions. We are looking forward to what promises to be an interesting and hugely enriching session. I would personally not have been brave enough to accept the challenge of talking to the theme of today. I therefore wish all our speakers well in their given tasks and for agreeing to participate. Mine is not the task of welcoming the guests, but to introduce our next speaker, who himself needs no further introduction. Because of his eminence, I shall not venture into it. Honorable Minister, may I now ask you to welcome our guests and to present the keynote address as requested, please. I thank you.
Thank you so much, Your Excellency. Dear Commissioner, dear ambassadors, distinguished speakers, my dear guests, it is with great pleasure that I'm opening Africa Day celebrations here in Athens today. Let me welcome you all and thank you for your kind participation. I hope that next year we will be able to host you again physically at the Foreign Ministry. Please allow me first to congratulate the Ambassador of South Africa and the group of African ambassadors in Athens for putting together a high-level program in collaboration with the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Let me also extend a warm welcome to Her Excellency Ms. Amira Elfadil, Mohammed Elfadil, Commissioner for Health, Humanitarian Affairs and Social Development, representing the great organization we're honoring today, the African Union, an organization with great achievements in establishing a prosperous and peaceful Africa, an organization which is playing an increasingly important role in the continent's security architecture. In addition to African Union's achievements, one of the great endeavors of the continent has been the creation of the African Continental Free Trade Area. This landmark development paves the way for Africa, with its 1.2 billion people, to become the world's largest common market. It is thus creating new opportunities for development and business around the continent. Africa has the potential to be the continent of opportunity in the 21st century. Rapid population growth, rich cultural diversity, dynamic societies and economies, all are reasons for ambition and optimism. At the same time, there are also challenges for Africa to overcome. African countries have been enjoying notable social and economic progress. However, there's a strong potential to improve everyday life for their people and provide effective healthcare system, education, and job opportunities for Africa's youth. Addressing these challenges is being further complicated by conflicts, trade fragility in specific regions of the continent, and climate change, raising serious geopolitical and security risks. Greece, which never had a colonial past in the region, has a long and valued relationship with African countries. By building on these long-standing relations, we're working towards further deepening our mutually beneficial partnerships. We are therefore aiming to strengthen our political, economic, and cultural ties with African nations bilaterally and at the international stage. Our growing engagement in Africa is being also demonstrated by the opening recently of our new embassy in Dakar, which will cover the biggest part of the Sahel region. Together with our other embassies, the general consulates, and honorary consulates in the continent, Greece will continue working with our African partners to expand our relations on the ground. In this vein, we are also working towards the elaboration of our first strategic priorities paper to guide our policies in the coming years for a strengthened partnership with Africa. The theme of African Union this year emphasizes the role art, culture and heritage can play as catalysts of socioeconomic development and integration of the African continent. Greece shares strong historic ties with many African nations, as well as a rich cultural legacy and valuable cross-cultural bonds. Moreover, the Greek dynamic diaspora in several African countries will continue to be a bridge of friendship and cooperation. Equally, African communities in Greece constitute a solid bridge of cooperation between Greece and the countries of their origin. Today, Greece works with its African partners in a forward-looking and ambitious spirit. Africa is at Greece's and Europe's immediate neighborhood, and the mutual prosperity and security of Europe and Africa are intertwined. We are working with the Portuguese presidency of the Council for a summit that will establish a stronger, more strategic, and more result-oriented partnership between Europe and Africa. A partnership that will reflect the interests of both sides and strengthen the ties between both continents. A genuine partnership of equals based on international law, focusing on people's needs as well as adjusting to the needs of a post-COVID world. I would like to conclude by assuring you that Greece will always be an active partner in Africa, a partner that will continue working for the enhancement of our long and strong ties of friendship and cooperation. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Minister. And now, as you also mentioned today, we are honoring the African Union and its contribution to unity, peace, development, solidarity. It is therefore a distinct pleasure to have Her Excellency Amin Elfadil Mohammed Elfadil, Commissioner for Social Affairs of the African Union Commission, addressing us today. Commissioner Elfadil is a seasoned politician from Sudan and a renowned activist for social development and human rights issues. During her current tenure, she's bringing the wealth of her valuable experience to the African Union Commission, and we will also have the privilege to benefit from her insights. Your Excellency, the floor is now yours. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Gounari, our moderator. Excellency, Minister of Foreign Affairs of the Hellenic Republic, Excellency, Deputy Minister of Culture and Sports of the Hellenic Republic, responsible for contemporary culture, Excellency, Ambassador of the Republic of South Africa, Dean of the African Group of Ambassadors in Greece, Excellency, Ambassador of the Arab Republic of Egypt, Excellencies, Ambassadors, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I am delighted to be invited and be part of the Africa Day 2021 celebrations organized by the African Group of Ambassadors in Athens. And at the onset, I thank you for this kind invitation to me to represent the African Union Commission in this event. At the custom every year, yesterday, the 25th of May, 2021, we celebrated Africa Day at the African Union headquarters. This anniversary commemorates the birth of the Organization of the African Unity, known as OAU. Today, it's the African Union, AU, established on May 25th, 1963. Indeed, by a Solomon Act, our founding fathers, keen to safeguard and consolidate the independence of our countries from colonization, and in a bid to strengthen solidarity across Africa and see through the task of the total liberation of Africa, did not only lay the foundation of our unity through a common African identity, shared values, and African renaissance, but also triggered the dynamics of actions and efforts towards continental integration and sustainable development that our continent is strongly pursuing today. I wish thus to congratulate all of us for the celebration of the 58th anniversary of the establishment of our continental organization, the African Union. So happy Africa Day. Excellencies, as you are aware, the AU theme of the year for 2021 is Arts, Culture, and Heritage, Levers for Building the Africa We Want. This theme is also the theme of the Africa Day celebrations throughout the continent and beyond. Excellency, since the adoption of the A theme of the year by the AU Assembly, many activities have been implemented, but one important event is the continental launch of the entry into force of the Charter for the African Cultural Renaissance, which was held yesterday during the celebrations of Africa Day. The Charter for Africa Cultural Renaissance was adopted by the 6th AU Assembly held in Khartoum, the Sudan, in January 2006, and entered into force in October 2020 upon receipt by the AU Commission of the 15 instruments of ratifications. But I always take this kind of opportunities to call upon our member states to sign and ratify the Charter. It is a very important cultural legal instrument, and we want to sign and ratify, and we also want to go for implementation. Excellencies, as we say, the theme of the year has brought to our department and to the Commission and to the continent and even to the world at large a golden opportunity to celebrate our African identity and shared values, our arts and culture and heritage, as well as work, gave us the opportunity to work toward the development and increased visibility of this unique and important sector. Many activities has been taking place at the continental level, especially in the implementation of the concept note on the theme of the year. I will very quickly mention just a few. We have held the second virtual forum of ministers of responsible for arts, culture, and heritage, which was attended by ministers and representatives from almost all our AU member states. Also, we convened a meeting for our partners, and this meeting allowed us to define our roles and ways of collaboration and joint implementation of the activities of the theme of the year. We have also held a webinar workshop with members of the Pan-African Parliament also to present some of our policy instruments. We have also convened the validation workshop of the revised AU Plan of Action on Cultural and Creative Industries. These are some of the activities, but I have a lot of activities that's going on the continental level. And unfortunately, because of COVID-19, all of these activities are virtual activities. We had the opportunity to have it in physical. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, this year, as it was for last year, we are still grappling with the COVID-19 pandemic. Hence, the theme of the year is also aimed at promoting the arts, culture, and heritage sector and building a resilient Africa, which provides primary healthcare and social services to all the aftermath of the COVID-19 pandemic. Excellencies, the focus of our policies and instrument includes the renewed continental and global interest in the viability of the cultural and creative industries as a springboard for Africa's integration, economic empowerment and social inclusion, plus sustainable development and job creation, especially for the young people and the young women in Africa. Excellencies, one of the flagship projects in the Great Museum of Africa, which is established to foster continental integration and showcase African narrative with regards to its past, plural culture, heritage, and outstanding cultural and natural beauty to its people and to the world at large. The Great Museum of Africa is designed to promote and support Africa's aspiration to become a leading global power whose growth is driven by its own citizens. And it's also allow us to use this opportunity to seek your support in the campaign for resource mobilization to construct the permanent site of the Great Museum of Africa, which is hosted in Algeria. I call upon all of you ambassadors here present in this event to support this very important project. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, allow me to conclude by once again expressing my utmost gratitude to address this August gathering and celebration of the Africa Day, and to mention that we look forward to your support as we move with the implementation of other programs in line with the AU theme of the year for 2021. Also, we are available and ready to join other initiatives organized by the African Group of Ambassadors related to the AU theme of the year for 2021, because my department is a leading department on the implementation of the theme of the year. Excellencies, ambassadors, excellencies, ministers, allow me to finish by saying thank you very much for your attention. And again, happy Africa Day to all of us. Thank you and shukran jazeela.
Thank you very much, Your Excellency. As our Minister of Foreign Affairs has to leave our meeting, I would like to sincerely thank him for his important speech and now turn to our next speaker. As we heard, African Union has declared the year 2021 as the year for arts, culture and heritage. It is now my privilege to welcome Deputy Minister for Culture and Sport, Mr. Nicholas Gatromanolakis, for his important address. Mr. Minister, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Mrs. Gounari. Dear host, Your Excellency, Ambassador Sisulu, Your Excellency, Ms. Amira Elfadil, Mohammed Elfadil, dear speakers, Your Excellencies, ambassadors, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much, first of all, for this invitation. It is an honor for me to celebrate African Day with you today, and also an honor that you have invited the Greek Ministry of Culture and Sports to contribute in the discussion regarding arts, culture, and heritage and how they can become levers for Africa's future. For obvious reasons, this is a topic that is very also important to us as well in Greece, as we share this, we have this thing in common. We both, Africa and Greece, share a very wealthy and rich cultural heritage, but also a very promising and very dynamic cultural present. And figuring out ways to actually leverage this artistic wealth in order to promote both financial economic growth and development and social cohesion is instrumental and key. The cultural and creative industries can indeed become drivers of growth and social inclusion. And also the creative economy is a sustainable form of economy, which actually thrives on the uniqueness that each locality has. This can actually work as a very important comparative advantage for all African nations. And actually, culture can be a key driver for the support of the achievement of the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, and at the same time, create multiple positive externalities beyond the intrinsic value that culture holds. Actually, there was a report that was done by the Rand Corporation a few years ago, and it has identified five main categories of benefits from culture and cultural activities and the impact it has on other sectors. These can be cognitive, as culture can improve actually learning skills and academic performances. So there is a strong link between culture and education. There is a strong link also between culture and social cohesion, as cultural experiences can develop more general skills and also pro-social skills. The comparative advantage and the benefits of culture on health and healthcare and welfare have also been proven by a recent study by the World Health Organization. And also the impact of arts to mental health is also very eminent. And then in terms of social skills, the benefits of social skills and the promotion of social interaction, community identity and social capital building is also obvious. And finally, last but not least, the economic benefits, both direct and indirect, in terms of job creation, in terms of tax revenues, spending, but also public goods and the contribution of the arts to the quality of life is also very important. All of these signify ways that actually culture can contribute greatly to the future growth of the African continent. And also, this happens at the time where we see cultural exports globally increasing as a share of world trade. And as Ambassador Sisulu stated earlier, this comes at a timely manner point where, because of the establishment of the African Trade Association, the AFTA, this becomes even more important. For these reasons, I do believe that investing in culture and arts and also the wealth of heritage that Africa holds, it is actually an investment that will bring many returns and will actually be a main component of the growth strategy for the years to come. As Ambassador Elfadil has actually mentioned, she mentioned a lot of very interesting and very important initiatives already taken by the African Union and by respective African nations. And I think, and I do believe, that this actually will be a key driver of growth. Of course, for this to happen, there are some prerequisites that have to be met. First of all, there has to be a certain level of infrastructure and stability in place in order for arts to thrive. Also, the respect of diversity and plurality and also the respect of the freedom of artistic expression are very, very important in order to encourage a thriving artistic community anywhere in the world. At the same time, the formation of a conducive environment that can create incentives and actually can establish new thriving creative industries is also instrumental. And also, as we are heading towards what is called right now the experience economies, that is economies that actually are holistic and link together different components from culture, from tourism, education, retail, and other experiences that visitors and citizens can actually enjoy. It is very important to link all these components together in order to maximize the impact that culture can have in the growth of the African continent. At this point, I would also like to allow me please to state a few words regarding the growing ties, cultural ties between Africa, African nations, and Greece. I will give you some very brief examples of things that have been happening in the past couple of years, but I do believe that they are very important and also signify the importance that the Greek government and Greece as a whole gives to contemporary African culture. So for example, you might know that the National Museum of Contemporary Art opened its doors for the first time on a daily basis last year. Unfortunately, just a few days before the pandemic struck. When it reopened its doors in the summer of 2020, and again 2 weeks ago when all Greek museums reopened, it is actually very interesting to note that it is hosting an exhibition on contemporary African art. The exhibition is called Ubuntu, and it hosts a series of African and African American artists, and actually explores the recurring and key themes of contemporary African art, which, as we all know, is one of the growing forms of art globally these days. It is not by coincidence that the National Museum of Contemporary Art in Athens would open its doors by hosting this important exhibition. Greece, having been one of the European nations that do not have a colonial past, can actually work as a bridge and as a blank canvas for these very important stories to be told. It is also very important to us to, through this exhibition, to actually showcase contemporary African art and to create cultural ties between the African nations and Greece, and also to introduce African art to a new Greek audience. At the same time, the celebration also of African music, contemporary African music, that also blends with the musical heritage of the African continent has been prominent in the past years in Greece. I'll just give you a quick example. In 2019, the Summer Knossos Festival that took place in Athens invited, among others, four influential DJs from Uganda, Tanzania, and Ghana to actually showcase their talent, and actually they attracted a very, very diverse and large audience of music followers. These are just few examples of things that actually can happen through the collaboration of contemporary African artists and Greece. And actually, we at the Ministry of Culture are very keen to foster this relationship and to actually strengthen the ties between the African continent and Greece, and also to exchange knowledge, know-how, but also to exchange cultural experiences between the African continent and the Hellenic Republic. We all know, as Ambassador Elfadil said, that the pandemic has actually hit the cultural industries worldwide very severely. And this makes the decision to honor the cultural industry this year even more important, because we will all need around the world to figure out ways to support the industry and to support cultural workers. At the same time, I do believe that the pandemic, amidst the chaos it caused, it also helped us to identify important issues and also to identify ways we can actually share our heritage and also our artistic production around the world. And this is something we see more and more happening in the past year. And I urge all of you to actually take advantage of these new opportunities that have actually emerged through this pandemic. By closing, I would like to again thank you for allowing me to celebrate Africa Day with you, and to reaffirm our commitment to actually strengthening our cultural ties between the African nations and Greece. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Minister, for your thought-provoking presentation. And before we continue with our distinguished panelists, we will screen a short video on Africa. We hope you will enjoy it.
Africa United.
Στις 25 Μαΐου το 1963, η Αφρική έγραψε ιστορία ιδρύοντας τον Οργανισμό Αφρικανικής Ενότητας, που είναι ο προπομπός της Αφρικανικής Ένωσης. 30 ηγέτες από 32 ανεξάρτητα κράτη υπέγραψαν την ιδρυτική διακήρυξη στην Αντίς Αμπέμπα της Αιθιοπίας. Η ημέρα της Αφρικής είναι η επέτειος του εορτασμού των επιτυχιών του Οργανισμού της Αφρικανικής Ένωσης, των αγώνων της κατά της απεικιοκρατίας, κατά του Απαρτχάιντ, των αγώνων για την ευημερία των λαών, την πολυπολιτισμική πολυμορφία της Αφρικανικής Ηπείρου. Κάθε χρόνο εορτάζεται στις 25 Μαΐου η ημέρα της Αφρικής σε παγκόσμιο επίπεδο για να αναδείξει τις επιτυχίες και τα επιτεύγματα των λαών της Αφρικής.
Africa United. Africa.
Mama Africa, womb of mankind. Cradle of cultures and religions. Africa, from the past, the present, and the future. Africa of multicultural societies, of poets, writers, and actors, of singers and painters, of marathon runners and fighters, of revolutionists and great visionaries and leaders. Mama Africa, of polytheistic and monotheistic religions, of open horizons and wide borders, of seas and oceans, of lakes and rivers, of deserts, savannas, and mystical jungles, of vast plains and heroic mountain ranges, of magnificent animals, of traditional settlements and gigantic metropolises, of conflicts and peace, of nemesis, forgiveness, and oblivion, of contrast and synthesis. Mama Africa, of rapid growth and the blue economy, of opportunities and wealth, of hydrocarbons and minerals, of coffee and tea, of flowers and tobacco, of geothermal, solar, and wind energy, of abundant raw materials, of gems, gold, sun, and moon, of rural economy, of small and medium-sized industry, of heavy industry, of ecology and tourism, of education and health. Mama Africa of 55 states, of more than 1 billion people, of the numerous very young people. Africa, emerging giant of the 22nd century. Africa of our future. Africa of our hearts. Our Africa. Your Africa.
Africa, united. Africa.
I'm sure you will agree with me that this was a powerful and inspiring video. Now let's move to the second part of our Africa Day. We have a panel with three eminent speakers who will highlight different and very pertinent aspects related to Africa. Our first panelist is Mr. Spiros Kouvelis. Mr. Kouvelis served as Minister of State for Foreign, Economic, Environmental and Cultural Affairs. Currently as Director of the EPLO Institute for Sustainable Development and having held several other important positions in this area, he will make a presentation on human heritage in the context of sustainable development, climate change and the EU Green Deal, opportunities for cooperation between the EU and the African Union. Mr. Kouvelis, please, the floor is now yours.
Thank you so much, Ambassador, and thank you to all the organizers for inviting me to take the floor in this very, very important initiative for celebrating Africa Day today. I would like to extend my thanks and my greetings to Minister Yetro Manolakis, Minister Saris, and the ambassadors that are participating, my very good friend Sotiris Moussouris. And it's my pleasure and honor to be in this event with you. First of all, congratulations, as I said, for the initiative taken by the ambassadors of the African countries and the Hellenic Ministry for Foreign Affairs and the African Union. And I will be speaking a little bit about the connection of sustainable development and culture and heritage, because I think there is a very strong linkage. And if you allow me, I would also like to share some slides that probably will make it easier for me to carry the message of what I would like to share with you. But before I start sharing the screen, what I would like to say is that culture and heritage and the way people create culture is not something that happens in a void of the economic and social conditions in which it happens. And even more, I think that culture emerges from the economic conditions is shaped by them, but it's something that shapes those conditions. And this keep in mind. So to share this very brief presentation, actually, I will be speaking about the human heritage in the context of sustainable development, climate change, and the European Union Green Deal, and the opportunities that this presents for linkages and cooperation between the European Union, the African Union, and of course, the countries in Africa. As I said, we are trying to view the concept of how culture and heritage happens within the socioeconomic context. And one basic point to start from is what is happening in terms of economic development. This is a picture of 2016. I don't remember who from, the World Bank, actually, that shows how the GDP is distributed among different parts of the world. And as we see, one of the strongest parts of weakness in the distribution of GDP is Africa in itself, which means that the wealth is not divided equally, as we all know, among different places, but Africa is lagging behind. And this is a limiting factor in how investment can happen, but also in how culture will be one of the driving forces for development. The second level has to do with food and hunger. This is of 2018 of the Global Hunger Map. Two important things here. We see that Africa, again, is in the heart of many of the problems that exist along with this part of Asia. But also, I would like to draw your attention to this final last bit here that says climate variability and extremes are among key drivers of hunger. And this is important because this is connected also to how culture can be developed and how, in return, can be a source for people's livelihoods. Third point, the burden of disease, public health. It's sad to see that one of the most affected areas of the world is Africa, again, in terms of how diseases are taking a toll on human lives. And that's important to take into account. So lots of problems that are happening in the world can be concentrated and seen as important factors happening in Africa. But not what are the important things to develop. One of them is education, especially education for young women and girls. I find this slide to be tremendously interesting. It's created by the European Union, and it shows in terms of growth of the global population. Today, that was 2015. At that time, we're standing at 1.2 billion in Africa out of 7.3 billion in the world overall, with a total fertility rate of 4.7%. And the European Commission at the time had calculated that if by 2060 there was a rapid education development, that would mean that the overall population in Africa would be contained to 1.9 billion as part of the 8.9 billion in the world, with the fertility rate dropping to 1.51. If the education trend goes in the continued way that it goes today, we would have an increase of the population to 2.5 billion and fertility rate to 2.26. And if the process was stalled, that would mean that 3.2 of the overall 11 billion that the world would be reaching by 2015 would be in Africa. That is something that increases the problems that I mentioned before. And so, as Minister Yetromanolakis mentioned before, education and culture are two things that are totally interlinked between them. So I'd like to keep this point for reference in our discussion afterwards. Climate change. On climate change, there's not enough words to say how important it is. This is a map that was published by the Norwegian Refugee Council and the IDMC in 2012, and it shows that in 2012, we had 32.4 million people displaced because of climate change. Very importantly, some of them happened in Chad, in Niger, in Nigeria, in Madagascar, in South Sudan, all of them related to extreme weather phenomena, and also, of course, in other parts of the world. So the potential of people to work, to flourish, and to develop livelihoods and culture is very much limited, and this is a factor that will be increasing in the years to come. Now, we all know that the Sustainable Development Goals were established in 2015 in order to address the problems that I mentioned, those mega trends, if you like, that I mentioned, like poverty, hunger, health issues, and so on. And they look into issues that need to be taken into account in bettering the livelihoods of people. Culture is one of them. And although it is not as such mentioned in one specific goal of the Sustainable Development Goals, it cuts through horizontally many, many of them. So inequalities, sustainable cities, the way that we have work and economic growth, hunger, and so on, is very important. And I will show you what I believe. This is a slide that I find very interesting. It is created by a friend who works on culture in the UK. And what it shows is that we're used to having a discussion about sustainable development that takes into account environmental, economic, and social issues. Those three pillars, as they're mentioned, the pillars of sustainability. However, this slide shows a fourth pillar that we consider equally important, and this is what I think we are talking about today. Cultural aspects. The cultural aspects, not only the sense of image and symbols creation, but very importantly, the creation of identity, the sense of place, the place where people live that is connected to their heritage, to their nature, to the way they create, and so on. The cultural landscapes, the education, knowledge, skills, education and knowledge skills, all of these parts are very, very important for the sustainable development in the place. And just to give you two examples, that's coming from Morocco, a country that I'm very closely related to through friendly relationships, and I have visited many times. At one time, I was doing a study with the United Nations about how the economy is aligned with the sustainable development goals. And I had a meeting with a minister for artifacts and industry. And this minister actually explained to me that the artifacts of Morocco that we all know, actually, contrary to what somebody would believe, are not in their majority items that are exported or sold to tourists. The artifacts that are created by many people of Morocco that work in this sector are used to a rate of about 60 to 70% in everyday uses in households in Morocco. And that means that this heritage, because it is a very strong heritage, not only in the in this type of artifacts, but in many other things, is a very important part of everyday life in the economy and society. Second sector, the artisanal fisheries. This is a picture from the port of Essaouira, one of the most beautiful places I've ever been. And I'm mentioning it because I think that traditional fisheries and coastal fisheries is a very important thing in relation also to the blue economy that we heard in the video that we heard before, because not only it works in a sustainable way on how fisheries are implemented, but it provides a very, very important heritage in the way that culture has been evolving in the sector of tourism and in coastal development, but also provides livelihoods in small scale activities for entire families that depend on it. So you see the interlinkage between what we call heritage, and it's not just arts, it's everything that is related to people's lives, and how sustainable development can happen is very, very important. In this, I think, and it was mentioned by Minister Dendias before, Europe is becoming a leader globally. It is actually the leader globally in what we call the Green Deal and a shift to a new economy that takes into account the need to have a sustainable future in terms of consumption, production, circularity, but also in terms of addressing climate change. And among the targets of the European Green Deal that will be channeling no less than 130 billion euro from now until 2027, if I remember. There are many things that have to do specifically with climate change, but also smarter mobility, green industry, and so on. One of the things I wanted, two of the things that I wanted to single out is on one hand, the farm to fork part, which is the production of food. And in this way, the local knowledge and the heritage existing in the countries around Africa is very important to preserve and to make better. But also there is one specific priority of the European Union to lead the green change globally. And that means that the European Union is extending a lot of collaboration also through its external action, but through every one of its directorate general to collaborate with whole regions of the world, including Africa, including the North African states through the Euro-Mediterranean collaboration, in being able to promote new technologies, to promote the use of traditional technologies and heritage and so on. One last example that I want to share with you is this initiative that was created by the Portuguese presidency of the European Union and the European Investment Bank, which was a dialogue on Africa's green future. It was part of the green talks between EU and Africa. And it led to the emergence of many points of collaboration between the two regions of the world, the two very important regions of the world. So I believe that this is one context in which we need to concentrate very much. We need to concentrate on how this global heritage that emerges from Africa can be of use to first bettering the future of Africa in itself, in livelihoods, in economic development, and in securing human life and addressing the big challenges that I mentioned before, but also how things and ideas that emerge from Africa might be useful to the rest of the world. And I think that Africa has now reached the point where by increased mobility and increased communication potential through especially mobile phone connection and internet, as it is emerging more and more in the region, will be able to provide new solutions also to other parts of the world and not only in itself. With this, I would like to conclude. I will be very happy to participate in any ensuing discussion and, of course, to get in touch with any of you participating or those that are listening to us. And again, thank you so much for your invitation to participate in this event. Thank you.
So, Minister, thank you very much. You highlighted some very important points, and they were also complementing the contribution we had earlier from Minister Yatromanolakis. And now let's move on to our next speaker, Mr. Michael Saris. Mr. Saris served as Minister of Finance of the Republic of Cyprus, also, I think, during very challenging times. Mr. Saris has a long experience with the World Bank on a broad range of sectors, and he will also provide some very, I think, interesting insights on a very pertinent subject, which is on the post-pandemic social and economic challenges for Africa. So, Mr. Saris, now the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Gounari. Thank you so much also to the organizers, and greetings to my fellow speakers and all participants. As Ambassador Gounari has said, I worked for many years in development, most of them on Africa. And once you work on Africa, your fond memories stay with you for life, and so do the friendships you build. Now, I will talk about the post-pandemic era, the economic aspects for Africa. Africa is a continent of enormous economic potential, as we all know, which for generations has remained largely unrealized. But in the years before the pandemic, a combination of factors, such as political stability, better microeconomic and structural policies, improving governance, and more effective international financial assistance led to remarkable progress in achieving faster economic growth and reducing poverty. This promising phase in Africa's development was weakened by lower commodity prices after 2012 and then interrupted by the severe impact of the COVID-19 pandemic. In 2020, real GDP in Africa is estimated to have contracted by 2%, less than the contraction in advanced economies, other emerging economies, and developing economies, excluding China. This reflects a slower spread of the virus, strong agricultural growth, and recovery in commodity prices. The relatively milder impact masks other Africa-specific negative effects which can permanently damage the region's medium-term development prospects. For example, learning loss in Africa is estimated to be 4 times that of advanced economies. This is a serious matter because even in the good years before the pandemic, while school enrollments had gone up, learning outcomes had not improved. The World Bank uses a new poverty indicator labeled learning poverty. Poverty, in other words, connected to learning deficiencies, which is the share of 10-year-olds who cannot read. School time lost because of the pandemic will only make worse already appalling learning outcomes despite a lot of money spent on education. According to the World Bank and the IMF, economic activity in the region is expected to rise in the range between 2.5% and 3.5%, depending on the policy measures adopted by countries and the level of financial assistance. This compares to an expected growth rate of 6% for the world economy. Thus, per capita incomes in Africa will continue to diverge with the rest of the world. Economic recovery in Africa is not expected to be uniform, but will vary across countries and sub-regions. A key factor in sustaining economic growth is the speed of vaccine rollout. At the end of April of 2021, only 2% of the African population was vaccinated, compared to 40% in the United States and 20% in Europe. Vaccines in Africa is a public good, is a global public good. Accelerating the vaccination of Africans is not only key for the social and economic prospects of the region, but also important for defeating the virus in the rest of the world. Making available as many vaccines as quickly as possible for Africa should be a top priority for all of us. Unprecedented fiscal and monetary expansion to support employment and incomes and keep enterprises alive have helped limit the impact of the pandemic worldwide. Fiscal space in Africa has been relatively limited by poor domestic revenue mobilization and already high external debt. Going forward, sustainable recovery will require the creation of additional fiscal space. It is estimated that the shortfall of what is needed to do the job is about 300 billion euro. Improving domestic tax mobilization will be important, but reducing Africans' debt burden through debt relief will be critical. A lower debt burden will release resources for public investment in areas such as education, health, and infrastructure. This investment will help Africa take advantage of the shifts in the global economy towards a digitally driven, low carbon, and climate resilient growth. As noted earlier, higher, but more importantly, better quality investments in human capital will help reduce the risk of long-lasting negative impact from the pandemic. Beyond debt relief, the rest of the world needs to step up bilateral and multilateral assistance to Africa. The African Development Bank, the World Bank, and the IMF have been quick in mobilizing additional financial support for Africa, and so have development agencies in advanced economies. This will need to be sustained and, wherever possible, enhanced. To complement public investments, invest in the private sector, domestic and international, needs to be encouraged. Private sector investment to create jobs requires an improved policy framework. Policies to support short-term recovery should be complemented by structural reform to encourage sustained productive investment, thereby enhancing competitiveness and productivity. Actions at home beyond structural reform need to give priority to better public services and improved governance. For the medium term, Africa needs to grow between 7 and 10% a year to create jobs for the young and reduce poverty and to begin to converge to the rest of the world in terms of per capita income. This is a big challenge, but the post-pandemic period may provide a unique opportunity to jumpstart economies throughout Africa. As already noted, improving the investment climate through private sector friendly influence is key. But as in other parts of the world, the role of the state in Africa has assumed a new central importance because of the pandemic. Governments in Africa will have the resources and the opportunity to make a real difference in people's life for the first time in a long time. But to do that effectively, they must improve their efficiency and, above all, regain the lost trust of people in government. The post-pandemic era for Africa is full of challenges, but also full of great promise. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Mr. Minister. And now the last speaker is Dr. Sotiris Moussouris. And Dr. Moussouris is the president and founder of the Hellenic African Chamber of Commerce and Development. Of course, Mr. Moussouris has a long and impressive career with the United Nations. Amongst other important positions, he's holding as member of boards of several cultural, educational, and human rights institutions. Who would be better fit to talk to us about why African cultural heritage matters? We are looking forward to your intervention, sir.
Thank you, Your Excellencies, Ambassadors. I think Mrs. Sisulu and Mrs. Madame Gounari had prepared a very interesting, organized a very interesting occasion. Thanks to the pandemic issues, we are having an informative, exciting discussion, and it is more or less what we had dreamt when we established, when we created the Hellenic African Chamber of Commerce and Development 21 years ago. Today we're discussing African cultural heritage. The cultural heritage of each African community, of each African country matters. It reflects its life, its history, its identity. It makes the past, it links the past with the present and the present with the future. It inspires and enforces social cohesion. Furthermore, it is essential for self-assurance, which in its turn is necessary for creativity and personal as well as national development. This heritage should be protected and be part of the lives of its citizens, especially of the young people who need to learn and be inspired from it, the way young people and artists from the West are inspired from African art, especially from music, sculpture, and painting. Yet, how can they be inspired? How can they reassure their identity? How can they understand the present without the knowledge of the past, when almost 90% of the physical cultural heritage of Sub-Saharan Africa is outside Africa? The most part of the cultural objects missing were the victims of colonization, which is a way to rob the memory, the continent. 40 years ago, the Senegalese head of UNESCO emphasized this problem and said, these men and women of Africa who have been deprived of their cultural heritage ask for the return of at least the art treasures which best represent their culture, where they feel are the most vital and whose absence causes them the greatest anguish. This is a legitimate claim. At last, the French president, Emmanuel Macron, was the first Western leader responding to that claim. In 2017, stating that the crimes of European colonization cannot be disputed and that the African heritage should not be found only in private collections and museums, he commissioned two academics to study the matter and offer recommendations. The report, the Sars-Savoie report, called for restitution of several artifacts to African countries, a timetable, and programs of joint research, training, and exchange. Consequently, President Macron announced the return of 26 bronze items to Benin on the basis of a law that the National Assembly passed a few months ago regarding the removal of archaeological treasures from national collections for restitution purposes. Although the historic initiative of President Macron created strong reactions, mostly negative, in several quarters, especially in museums in the West, a debate has commenced and certain sporadic restitutions have occurred. Of course, one hears the pretext that the Africans would be unable to store properly returned artifacts, a familiar argument of the British Museum as regards the sculptures of Parthenon. We answer with the new Museum of Acropolis, for which I am proud to have played a role. The cultural heritage of Africa, the North and the Sub-Saharan Africa is immense and varied. The cultural treasures from the monuments of Egypt to the mausoleum and manuscripts of Timbuktu, the bronzes of Benin, the wooden sculptures of Nigeria, the art of Ife and Obu, the Ashanti buildings of Ghana, Aksum and Gandhar, and the objects of Magdalen, Ethiopia, the stuffed lions and the Masa art of Kenya, the sculptures of Zimbabwe, the Zulu art of South Africa, even the Afoakon statue from Cameroon, which recently appeared for sale in a New York gallery and was repatriated, are only some of the vast and different elements of African art treasures, from jewelry to monuments, from the one to 2,000 languages and dialects. African governments, realizing the enormousness of the task, have taken various actions, often with international assistance and within, of course, their economic means, towards protecting and preserving this rich heritage. For instance, in 1989, the Southern Africa Coordination Conference, SADC, assisted by UNESCO and Nordic countries, formed an association of museums to collaborate for the cultural and natural heritage. The Museum of Black Civilizations opened in Dakar in 2018. The Jait Smoka Museum of Contemporary Art is thriving in South Africa. And I am very happy to hear the discussion, the presentation of Minister Yatron Manolakis, who talked about the contemporary art of Africa now. According to Wole Soyinka, the Nigerian Nobel laureate, who participated in the Athens Symposium Culture Against Apartheid in 1988, organized by my UN office and chaired by Melina Mercuri, he said, culture is an expression of a total way of productive life. Cultural continuity and cohesion aid communities in discovering and marketing new products and technologies. And Professor Mazui wondered whether Africa needs cultural engineering, namely purposefully useful use of culture for economic development. There are also, of course, economic implications. They have been mentioned. In the European Union, 7.5% of the employment comes from the cultural activities. And the United States museums contribute $50 billion annually to the US economy. Africa should also benefit. And their international collaboration is important. The factors in Africa are present. The talent and the resilience, especially of the women of Africa, this great African advantage. The traditions, the inventive spirit, the dynamism are present. The African cultural heritage matters. It can help to build the Africa we want. We at the Hellenic African Chamber of Commerce and Development will inscribe it permanently in our agenda and help to introduce also contemporary African art to our compatriots. Thank you.
We thank you, Dr. Moussouris. And now I would like to ask our distinguished colleague, Ambassador Ismail Kaira from Egypt, to deliver some closing remarks. Your Excellency Ambassador, the floor is now yours.
Thank you so much. And I was honored today to present the closing remarks of this meeting, which is very dear to me as we are celebrating the Africa Day. And on behalf of the African group, I would like to express our sincere gratitude to His Excellency Minister Dendias for honoring us with his participation today, marking Africa Day, and to express our sincere appreciation to the Greek Ministry of Foreign Affairs for the efforts and assistance in preparing for this event. I want also to extend my appreciation to Her Excellency Ms. Amira Elfadil, Commissioner of Health, Humanitarian Affairs and Social Development of the African Union, and our distinguished guests for joining us today. Also, I would like to express our appreciation to all fellow speakers for their contribution today. Moreover, a big thanks to Ms. Vasiliki Gounari for coordinating this meeting and a very good effort. Thank you so much. Furthermore, I would like to thank my colleagues in the African group for the tireless efforts in holding this event despite the challenges, especially our dean of the African group, my dear colleague, Her Excellency Ambassador of South Africa, Ms. Beryl, Sisulu, and the committee tasked with preparing the event. Your hard work has allowed us to gather here today to celebrate our beautiful continent. As we gather here today to celebrate Africa Day, the entire world is facing unprecedented challenges due to the COVID-19 pandemic. Despite this, the African group, in collaboration with the Minister of Foreign Affairs of the Hellenic Republic, decided to organize this event virtually in order for us to celebrate together the African continent, rich history, culture, and heritage. Since the times of the Minoans, Greece has always been one of the closest European countries to our African continent, not only due to its geographical proximity, but more importantly, because of its constant desire to establish friendly relations, cultural exchange, and trade with its neighbors in what could be considered traditionally Greek cultural traits that are still exhibited of this day. During these challenging times, it is imperative that we strive together to strengthen this historical bond between Greece and our African continents even further and boost our relations to various sectors, including trade, culture, and to exchange the best practice and know-how in managing the corona pandemic. During Egypt's chairmanship of the African Union in 2019, President Sisi announced the launching of African Continental Free Trade Zone, AFTA, a historical milestone which will create a single market with a population of 1.3 billion and a total GPD of 3.4 trillion USD, and which has the potential of unlock Africa's huge economic potential. Greece, as a world leader in global shipping and its extensive links with European ports and inland corridors, has the ability to play a leading role in facilitating trade between the African continent and the European, in Europe and beyond. I believe that many speakers today had referred to the African free trade area as a vital and is an important initiative that has been made for Africa. And I believe that this initiative can promote the African trade eminently. Today we have many speakers, and it is great pleasure that Minister Dendias, among his other duties, he participate today with some words in order to celebrate this day with us. And we are very glad to hear about Greece's commitment to enhance engagement with the African continent and the close cooperation with the Portuguese chairmanship of the EU to further boost EU and AU relations. I believe Greece can play a unique role in bringing our continent together due to its strategic location and capabilities. In addition to its friendly ties with African countries, I am confident that the strategic policy paper announced by His Excellency Minister Dendias on Greek relations with Africa has the potential to become a milestone in Greek-African relations in allowing us to formulate strategic partnership going forward. Moreover, we have heard also to Ms. Amira Elfadil, Commissioner for Health, Humanitarian Affairs and Social Development of the African Union. And I would like in this regard to thank Her Excellency Ms. Elfadil for highlighting the many activities taking place on the continental level and beyond. I also commended the EU for this year's theme value, Art, Culture, and Heritage, which gives great hope in the theme of the pandemic as our speakers have emphasized, African culture has a key role in promoting our continent and to serve as a key pillar of our growth. Mr. Yatru Manokaris, Deputy Minister of Culture and Sports, also, I agree with him. Greece is an unique is in a unique position to play a key role in enhancing cultural relations between the African continent with the European continent and beyond. I commended the Greek Ministry of Culture for hosting an exhibition on contemporary African art. I believe art has a powerful role to play. Mr. Spiros Kouveris, Director of Institute for Sustainable Development and Foreign Minister of State for Foreign Economic Culture, has highlighted many challenges that faces the African continent and the need to improve socioeconomic in order to unlock African economic potentials. Additionally, I agree there is a need to mitigate the efforts of climate change, improve education, and increase investment. Climate change is one of the most important topics that African states are dealing with, and Egypt among African states looking forward in order to implement all Paris conference outcome with regards to Africa. Also, we had Mr. Cyrus, former Minister of Economic Affairs in Cyprus, stressed the need to improve governance and the economic policy framework and the investment climate in the post-pandemic period in order to jumpstart the economy. I commend all the effort to step up the multilateral assistance to Africa and encourage investment in our continent in the post-pandemic area. Last but not least, Ms. Dr. Mouzouris, President and Founder of the Hellenic African Chamber of Commerce and Development and former Assistant Secretary General of the United Nations. I thank him for speaking about the restitution of Africa treasures. Egypt supports all the efforts, and I believe that all the African countries support all the efforts to bring back Africa artifacts back to its original countries. I cannot stress how important it is for Africans to take back the treasures for which they have been deprived all their lives. As you all know, it is one of the most important issues that African states are striving. And for Egypt, we are opening very soon the Grand Museum. I believe that it will be very good that we can return all our artifacts back to Egypt in order to be exhibited in the new museum. Thank you once again for giving me this opportunity celebrating the Africa Day, and in closing, giving the closing remarks, I thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ambassador. And now let me conclude our meeting by thanking all the speakers for your thought-provoking contributions. It gave us an opportunity to revisit and reconfirm what my minister said earlier on about the strong and long relations Greece has with our African partners, and our wish to further promote and enhance this partnership, either on a bilateral, multilateral level with our EU and international partners. So now time has come. A special thanks goes to the distinguished ambassador of South Africa here in Athens, Beryl, to you and the group of African ambassadors in Athens for making this event possible. Last but not least, we would like to thank the participants and renew our appointment for next year, hopefully back at our ministry premises. With that, I thank you all and I wish you a very nice day and a very nice Africa day. Thank you all.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Jerusalem, ikhaya lami, ngilondoloze, uhambe nami, zunga ngishilala. Jerusalem, ikhaya lami, ngilondoloze, uhambe nami, zunga ngishilala. Ndawo yami, angikholana, mbuso wami, angikholana, ngilondoloze, zuma.